questions. But before we go on, I'm going to invite Professor Densil Williams to just give some remarks.
Thank you, Chair, colleagues, colleague head, Dr. Waller, Dr. King, members of the platform party, other invited members, one and all. I'm very happy to be here this evening to share in this important discussion. Now, I think I must make a declaration that I'm from Westmoreland. Based on the context of what was discussed. But on a serious note, let me thank the organizers for this this discussion this evening. I think it is quite timely. But what I will do in giving a few remarks is to really pose a few questions which I think should be considered as you think through the development of this very nascent industry. It is important because while a lot of arguments have been put forward, I do not think that we have substantive empirical evidence from the Jamaican context to make definitive conclusions about where we ought to go with this industry. So it's going to require a bit more work to sort of understand what is it that we really is getting into as an industry. So while these thoughts are important, I think it is a very timely way to have discussions, to have the debate, to put the thoughts together so that we can go back and engage in much more rigorous analytical work to better understand the sort of industry that we're trying to build. Because as you know, building an industry is not an effortless task. And if we really want to do it well, we have to spend some time to think very seriously about what we're doing. So it's in that context why I'm going to raise a few questions that I hope that the organizers and all those who are interested in this line of work will have to actually contemplate as they think through some of the issues to grapple with. Now, Dr. Knife has identified what he calls the elements of a business model for this particular industry. So, it is important to identify the elements, but at the end of the day, what you really still need to do is to concretize what is it that you're going to put together in order to make money. So in essence, what a business model is really that set of activities that you're putting together to make money. So the question becomes, what is really going to be the business model for an industry of this type? And it's actually very novel in its own right. Given all that Dr. Howard has said about the different types of products, etc., it is not just a normal industry that you're going to be dealing with. So therefore, you have to understand what is the model that you're going to deal with surrounding that industry. Similarly, you need to also understand the value chain of this particular industry that you're getting into. What you do not want to do is to run the risk of saying, yes, there's an opportunity for an industry, but we focus on only the low-end part of the industry and allow the high-value part of the industry to be captured by different people in different sectors. We have done it, for example, in bauxite. We have done it in other agricultural industries. We need to be very careful about this one that we're talking about and see very early in the game what is the value chain. I mean, we have seen it in sports, for example. A lot of us think that getting the money out of sports is just going to the national stadium and making some noise and stuff. That's the low-value part of the industry. The high-value part of the industry is not controlled by us at all. So we really need to understand the value chain for this particular industry that we're proposing and see where in that chain we really need to be the player so that we can extract the greatest value from it. Similarly, we need to ensure that the industry does not become another enclave industry like as we see in most economies that are endowed with natural resources, and these industries that are developed around these economies generally are locked off from the rest of the economy and a few people benefit from them. A classic case in point is oil. Everybody knows how the oil industry actually operates. Very enclave, very few people actually benefit from it. Well, if we're thinking about this as a mass produced mass benefit, to deliver mass benefit to a population, then we have to think very seriously about the structuring of the industry so that even if it becomes an enclave, it becomes an enclave that has serious linkages to the rest of the economy so that not only a few people benefit, but the masses can actually benefit. So again, we have to start thinking about things like that as well. Similarly, I think it is important for us to also consider the geopolitical, geo-business, and geo-economic issues surrounding this industry as well. Let us not sit here and pretend for one moment that the geopolitics of an industry of this nature is not going to be critical, and I would say possibly the most fundamental in determining the structure of an industry that you're trying to prepare of this nature. So it is very critical that you identify some of the geopolitical issues that you're going to be dealing with, because again, let us not be tricked for one moment that a powerful country such as the United States, which has serious interest in an industry of this nature, is going to just sit by and allow you to develop an industry without thinking through some of the implications for themselves. Everybody has seen again what has happened with oil. One of the reasons why you see the oil industry the way that it is that if you recognize the U.S. outside of North Africa and the Middle East and Venezuela, the U.S. is one of the biggest players in the oil industry. If you think about it, Seven Sisters, who generally control the oil industry as well, if you think about it, five of them are actually located in the United States. So the geopolitics of this industry is really juxtaposed with the oil industry, and you have to also understand that before you actually think about even how you're going to develop the industry. So, ladies and gentlemen, I'm not going to go on for very long because, as I said, the presenters are here, they are really much more versed in these types of issues than I am. I'll go in for this one. It's very important to hear from them because they are really the people who are carrying out the work and carrying out the research and put forward the findings. But what I'm doing is to raise these important issues because I'm very convinced that if we're going to develop an industry that is going to benefit the majority of the people, we cannot make the same mistakes that we have made in the past in developing nascent industry and eventually is going to deliver great benefits to the people. So let us not also make the mistake that the industry will be controlled similar to the oil industry by the Seven Sisters and certain geopolitical state actors which have great interest in these and see the value. So let us understand the value chain of the industry so that we can better prepare ourselves to deliver on the industry. Thank you.
All right, we're going to move into the question and answer segment. Professor Williams, we're going to try to keep it tight. We want to do the question and answer for about no more than about 20-25 minutes for the first before we go into the second segment. All right, so we're going to try to get us about 4 or 5 questions and no more. And keep the question short.
Yes. Good afternoon. Dr. Barrett here from the Department of Sociology, Psychology and Social Work. And I want to say something about the legality of the herb and marijuana, as people refer to it. In Jamaica, there are two main strains of marijuana. There's sativa, cannabis sativa, and there's indica. Now, I purport that in the case of the Dangerous Drugs Act, it only refers to sativa and not indica. So that if one is in possession of indica, that particular strain, technically you are not violating the Dangerous Drug Act, and you can't be arrested for it. So that's something for your lawyers to chew over. Well, but having said that, I know that my colleagues here are well informed to actually comment on that. But this is a very important thing. So I would say that many a person are being violated, the human rights and the civil rights are violated if they happen to be smoking indica and they are arrested for smoking or being in possession of that, because the Dangerous Drugs Act refers to cannabis sativa, not indica. So let me put that one forward. I'm happy for a response. We've come.
Anyone, before we take a response? No, it is not really. It is saying, who's next? Keep it to a question. Let's go on to move on.
I have two questions originally, but I think I'm asking one of Dr. Klein. In relation to the business model of the ganja industry, I think what's key to it would be consistency. And one of the challenges I have found that we have had is that as it relates to genetics. If you look at the seed banks out of Amsterdam, they're exploding with varieties. And I'm not sure if in Jamaica we have been as sophisticated in our genetics of the plant. Would you push for us to sell popular strains or to enhance our local land rates to distinguish our local industry?
Yeah. answer the question already though. Because the reality is a seed war taking place. As I mean, so the reality, we need to find the one that we have out here. And as I said before, the universe is need to take that lead of finding that seed we have out through the east of Jamaica and start the multi-seed culture around it. Seed bank. Let me know, the money is not in the plant where you smoke, it's in the seed, you know. Five good seeds is $150 to $250. Five good seeds. Yes? Out of the border herb. So the key is really to find the seeds that we have out here. Once we have gotten that, then we can start about diversification. But right, if you don't have a seed, you don't really have a seed in business. No. It's not important.
As someone with a strong grounding in genetics, molecular biology, and collaborating with this same university through, I've been collaborating for 3 years now, medical faculty, through the auspices of Professor Wayne McLaughlin, and actually came to Jamaica in 1991 as a professor in molecular biology and genetics. That was in the Adventist American system. So I've been familiar with the research in the cannabis from those times and going back earlier. My comment here is about the Dr. Knife's model, which I find very thought-provoking, and I think it's well thought out. But the other question about the strains, it's a seed war, yes, but not just strains that are existent, but strains that may be brought to be through hybridization. I think Dr. Knife mentioned about the people in the Netherlands, Amsterdam. They have actually sent, I would call them, parties for, intelligence parties, literally, into Jamaica as strain hunters. I have a whole video on them. And the strain hunters have been very active here, while Jamaicans have been arguing about even supporting the Jamaican government to decriminalize and implement certain procedures, protocols, which will enable Jamaicans to benefit and stop locking up people for foolishness. The other problem here is differentiation between indica and sativa. There is no, the average policeman may not be able to do that. He's not trained in botany. He's not a herbarium person. This university has an excellent herbarium. The young man who's a curator, I've known him for donkey's years. In fact, he's doing a course with me about cannabis because I'm already a distributor for Colorado. Green culture here. So I have all the information in my archives. So it's like a joke. What I'm saying here is that this university needs to more than wake up, it needs to jump out of bed and literally do something about the Cinderella section, like the herbarium, and establish a proper archive. When you have an archive, you have somebody who is known to know about the strains and who can identify them. And in terms of courthouse issues, that person should be run, not the judge or the policeman. They are not botanists. And they would not allow a botanist to comment on medical, straight medical issues either. So what good for the boots, good for the gambler, sure.
All right, now, we have about 10 more minutes. I'm rather would ask questions. Not yet, David.
Thank you, everyone. This is for the School of Business, Dr. Andre Horton. The model you presented was basically discussing street herb in terms of the three grades you presented. I didn't consider the boutique herbs that are grown and sold in Kingston today at $400 or $500 an ounce, and which is sold in the high ends of the United States at $10,000 an ounce, which is a different model than you're presenting. Rob Clark, who collected indica, the sativa seeds here in the 60s when he spent 6 months, said that the real model for Jamaica is not to look on corn and soybeans and sugarcane and industrial crops of that scale, although we do have the capacity to produce those, to extract the oils for industrial inputs, but to look at it more as wine, which would give tremendous opportunities to every part and every community in Jamaica, and the community model of holistic health healing, and to look at a plant more from the wellness point of view rather than medicinal or recreational, which is the model presented by Steve DeAngelo of the Harborside Health Center in Oakland, which is the largest cannabis dispensary in the world today with 30,000 users buying from that particular dispensary. So I suggest you and ask that maybe you should reconsider the model and expand it to look at the boutique models as more suitable for Jamaica and the value added potential to every tourist room to add a holistic health aspect to those rooms, the value added to existing cabinets.
I agree. Most of the sample points, the sample units in my research are basically those in Westmoreland, St. Elizabeth, and St. Anne. I know of the industry that you're speaking about, but I do not know of the players, so I didn't get a chance to interview these people. So, if we can speak afterwards, if we can identify these people, then we can definitely fact that high strain, because that high strain to the modern is very important, because that is how it's produced abroad, and that is the way forward. So, I take the comment well, and we'll speak later afterwards about how best to incorporate this new information into research.
So next question.
Good evening, everybody. Greetings. Question in relation to a part of what the gentleman there had said, strain hunters coming here. That's actually a really good. You should check it out on YouTube. Strain hunters or greenhouse seed co. There are actually a lot of distributors that have been over there. But this is the question now. So I watched the video and I do some research on greenhouse seeds and what they do. They basically come and extract your seed from your country, take your land races, which means you have this specifically grow here, this type of paper, and then come for it and then just copy it up and sell it back to you 5-6 times the amount online. You can check that out. They came here like 3 or 4 years ago, but the video just came out last year, which means them done seal out the thing and get it good and I sell it back. You can check them Facebook now, right? Where they have a plant named Orange Hill for sale and I'm only out there, so we have that in them. So my question is, what do we do about persons who have been propagating and pushing Jamaican or that's land races or things like that, how we will help ourselves, as well as things like rolling paper, steam chalice, bun chalice, various other forms of consumption, extracting the oil through heating and whatever and crushing it, use back the thing as chicken feed, using back the mash as chicken feed. Will there be markets for that? Because I mean, legit, that is something me and try and it's easy for them. Anybody can do that at them yard. Hemp can take like hemp whip, mix that with some beeswax. Those are easy things they can literally do that at the yard. Watch the internet and do that. So what I want to know is, will there be, for example, a collection depot where somebody can go and be a part of that? Because it's not just about selling herb. If I want to grow some herb and I go there and smoke it, my bridging them or I go give it to people, the real money can be in the hemp stick itself. You can take them, grow up and all them something, as Dr. Knight said. So will there be, for example, as I said, a collection depot or whatever, set up for just the little farmer man, when he pick off the buds then, him knows that the stems still have use. So will there be some kind of thing for that? Because that's really where the money is. Because as I said, you can pre a matches box or seed can sell for like 10 grand in a, just a pre-dot. All right, thanks.
You spoke to the things that Dr. Williams raised in terms of the value chain. But the key thing is really, where is it going to be anchored? I think that's what they're really asking. You're right, it has to be anchored in communities. We're not bringing anything new to communities, man. We're just formalizing the structures. You know, and the beauty about ganja farmers, like those who come from Westmoreland, they have children like Densil, who's also very bright, who are in universities, who understand all these things that we speak about as scientists, you know? So it's not how to get to recognize them space as a wealth creation space. That really don't take a university, you know. It really take a shift in the mindset. Of course, we will go out here in the street doing this thing. So that's where our focus is. Our focus is really on the ground. I know other persons are looking at the other big players in the market. But unless we get the thing on the ground right, believe me, you will never see so much right in Jamaica if we try to get this thing in the big people hands. So for us, the safety of Jamaicans and Jamaican space, we need to get it where you're safe, get people on the ground to realize the value you can create at your household to generate wealth, not just a hand-to-mouth activity, but real wealth.
All right, the last question before
going
to the answer.
All right, good evening, everybody. The question is, who do we export to? Because, remember, Professor Williams mentioned that there are geopolitical issues for us to consider. And if many countries who, you know, have expressed interest still have marijuana being illegal, then our products to them, our products exported to them would be illegal. So who do we export to?
That's a very good question, and it lends us to qualify tourism itself, when people come here and consume Jamaican goods and services, that is also considered export. So because of the geopolitical aspects that Prof. William spoke about, and we already know based on UN treaty, etc., then it would be feasible for us to export marijuana. But I was speaking to one of his friends and we were discussing some things. We'll close our boundaries, but we'll have goods and services in here. And it's also important for us to do it this way, because whether marijuana is recreational or it is medicinal, or we make these products, wines, coffees, cakes, etc., we definitely want people to come here to get the Jamaican experience and to increase the money multiplier when they visit the shops to purchase food, they visit the craft market to purchase souvenir items, etc., etc. Straight across the board, we want these people to come here to boost tourism, not just as the service, but as the product itself from the marijuana and its byproducts.
Alright, moving on to the other segment, so we are bringing the legal ramifications. Now, Peter Tosh, in his song, Bush Doctor, said if we legalize marijuana, we can build up a public economy. But there are also legal ramifications to this. Even government moved towards decriminalization of ganja. We have to be careful to remember that Jamaica is a signatory to a lot of international conventions. These agreements, that Jamaica must be mindful not to breach, and the Justice Minister has been adamant about it in whenever he speaks, include the 1961 UN Single Convention on Narcotic Drug, and the 1972 Protocol amending the Single Convention, the 1971 UN Convention on Psychotropic Substances, and the 1988 UN Convention against Illicit Traffic in Narcotic Drugs and Psychotropic Substances. A lot of things to consider. One of the things these conventions do is that they don't mention medical and scientific uses of the drug or of ganja. But we have to be also mindful when we look at our own constitution, the Charter of Rights, which grants you the right to privacy and freedom of religion. And ganja is used in a religious sense in Jamaica. But I won't go on in that. I'll let Clyde Williams look at the ramifications surrounding the legalization of ganja in Jamaica to explain more from the legal perspective.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. You know, we like music because music can speak a lot better than persons. So we're going to start the presentation with a little Peter Tosh, because you don't know. From 1976, Tosh Attack didn't take it. Go to the track.
Don't criticize me.
So that's 1976. I don't even have to tell us here how many years ago that was. But we do have some problems. We do have some some specific international conventions that circumscribe how we position ourselves in terms of legalization. Densil, I'm glad you raised the geopolitical question, because I think we need to blow where the US wind is blowing. And that will take care of any geopolitical problems. In fact, right now, geopolitically, we are positioned. So I'd say wherever US wind is blowing, Colorado don't blow long time. Washington State, long time. Many of us coming on stream, and over 20 odd states already have medical marijuana programs. Colorado and Washington State have recreational marijuana programs. So it's like a stream. If we don't step now, Tosha tell me step near 40 years ago and we ain't step. If we do not step now, it's about getting into the market and establishing your presence. And I agree with, I can't speak on the economics and finance more eloquently than the learned men before. The idea who come on and before. But that tourist dollar that would explode is no accident. Hippies came to West Melania. These are not accidents. When the man used to have some real strong grade 6-9 months ganja, THC value high, cannabinoids high. That's the medicinal, more medicinal stream in the marijuana plant. They came here, and we just need to think about the value of travel dollar, the value of vacation spend globally, and trust me. So we have these conventions that we have signed on, and the brother mentioned earlier the 1961 convention. I just refer to it as a 61 convention that takes in the 72 amendment to it, the 71 convention, and the 1988 convention. I'll say at the outset that there is, in fact, debate in the walls of many countries and in the United Nations as to whether the conventions themselves prohibit, mean that cause you to have to make possession and use of marijuana a criminal offense. So I want to draw earlier distinction between the penalization of marijuana, which is what we have in Jamaica, and whether the conventions actually require the penalization of marijuana for recreational use. And whether, as in Colorado, they have positioned themselves around what they define as a flexible interpretation of the conventions. So they have gone, and even in my opinion, have been searching for some discussion around this item, haven't found it. I'm not saying it don't exist, it might be there, but I haven't found it. The Colorado legislature went constitutional, because the 1988 convention, in the opinion of several, pushed states to criminalize possession for recreational use. There is a divided opinion on it, because in that same specific convention, it gave states an alternative option. You could have an option to, but it ties it into, you know, not stigmatizing, ties it into educational and rehabilitation programs. So the commentary coming out of the United Nations itself demonstrates this struggle that is going on in terms of various viewpoints. And we look shortly on a few bits of commentary from the United Nations. Medical use for marijuana has always been something that the conventions embrace. Medical use, because it says the state shall work and try to prohibit use except for medicine and science. So I rock wheel around for Jamaica when the good doctor them stretch out in the early 70s, and we never go out there with them. it calls for a whole regulatory scheme, obviously, but medical use has always been allowed under the conventions, but it requires a certain rigid regulatory scheme. I'm not sure why we didn't develop that scheme, but as we know what the history is. So let's have a look at the 1961 convention that really sets out the basis. It's funny, this convention was helping, you know, wrapping up a lot of conventions, because about since 1909, thereabouts, they had begun to, you know, have these conventions against trafficking in narcotics and so on. So they refer to this as a single convention because it was to have, you know, pull all of them together. But as we know, there are two others. So interestingly, I found it an interesting kind of, it's like a broken trinity really. But it is what it is. There's the single convention, and then there's a 1971, well, sorry, there's a 72 amendment of the single 61 convention. So it's still that one convention as amended in 72. And then there is a 71 convention and an 88 convention. And the language of the convention, as you will see, conventions, is a language that is brought through compromise. So in 61, the general obligation of the Jamaican state to give effect to and carry out the provisions of this convention within their own territories, to cooperate with other states in the execution of the provisions of this convention, and C, so this is Article 4, C, subject to the provisions of this convention to limit exclusively to medical and scientific purposes the production, manufacture, export, import, distribution of, trade in, use, and possession of drugs. And drugs, you know, defining the whole of drugs. But the plants that they're focusing, we're talking about ganja, you know, marijuana, ganja. The plants we're focusing on is ganja. You had opium and you had coca. But that's for the Colombians and salt out and other guys down that side. We're talking ganja only here. So this convention and the commentary around this convention, I think it's considered settled commentary around this convention, because what the UN does, you know, after the convention, some years went off, and then they authorized some, you know, a body to do commentary, because people were raising questions, and states would be interpreting things differently. So the commentary would assist in the continued interpretation and standardization of practice. So the commentary on the 61 convention was in 1973. I think the convention came into effect, I don't think 63, that date has eluded me just now. But in 73 there was a commentary, and the commentary around the 61 convention was that it did not push a state to criminalize the personal use of ganja. It doesn't expressly anywhere in there says that. It does speak about, and we look at it very shortly, in Article 36, it does speak about, and we come to it, penal sanctions. So let's look at Article 36, because that's an important article to look at for this particular argument. Or not argument, really, point. And the commentary around Article 36, and you can go on the UN website and go 1961 convention as amended by the 1972 protocol commentary. And the commentary will come up, but it's a big document, they scanned it, so it takes a little while to load. The commentary around this, and let me just back up a little bit, please. 35 deals with action against illicit traffic. And how, you know, legal documents are drafted is not hearum scarum, you know, typically come in parts, even though the document may not say parts, but it typically come in parts to aid in the interpretation of the document. So you will see that Article 35 speaks about action against illicit traffic, And then Article 36 speaks about penal provisions. And it lists a couple, subject to its constitutional limitations. And that's why I said, the guys in Colorado, this is an opinion, you know, kind of like grill it up, you know, set it. Anyways, but that's an opinion. Subject to its constitutional limitations, each party shall adopt such measures as will ensure that cultivation, check, production, check, manufacture, extraction, preparation, possession. So possession here could mean individual possession. But let's continue. Possession, offering for sale, distribution, purchase, sale, delivery on any terms whatsoever, brokerage, and it goes on. But it does mention possession. Shall be punishable offenses when committed intentionally. But the commentary, and let me see if I can, oh, we don't take it down for the load. The commentary, my lord, the commentary on this particular convention says that given the history of the various drafts that this convention went through, and it had been divided in parts earlier, some earlier stage, and given the context in which Article 36 is located, that they were referring to possession for distribution. That's the commentary. This is not Clyde. Go online and check it out. I'm opening it up shortly. So that was the considered commentary at the time. So many countries, of course, then would utilize that and say, it does not. I'm talking penalizing, penal matters now. Walk with me, this is an important point. It doesn't legalize it, but it doesn't make it criminal. Walk with me. So how persons have interpreted is that you have to have civil infractions because you must try to prohibit the use of marijuana except for medical and scientific purposes. That then would mean recreational purposes would not therefore fall into that. So the state must take action, all actions, so as to prohibit, but not necessarily impose criminal penalty. So they, if you have heard the announcements of the government on their preliminary positions, it relate to, and I call them preliminary, it relate to a fine, you know, a civil infraction, like a police fine upon the road with more than 2 ounces. So we'll speak a little bit about that. You know, take it from you and, you know, probably issue with a little traffic ticket. But you wouldn't get a criminal record. So I want us to understand the distinction between legalization, because it still would not be legal, because it would be a civil infraction, but it wouldn't be met with the criminal law. It's an important point. So many states have used that to navigate. And remember, medical marijuana was always legal, so all you had, permitted under the convention, so all you had to do was to develop the regulatory framework, the laws, and satisfy the bodies in the UN that are responsible that the thing under control. So these are the penal provisions. These are, that's a commentary rather on some of these provisions. I might have lost exactly where. But there is this discussion around what exactly it means. And it came out on consensus, as I understand the literature, that it did not push the state to make criminal small, because talking only for recreational purposes, small for recreational purposes, not that you're a trader. It's a different argument entirely. So these conventions, then you had the 88 convention. Now that, I must confess, if you are pro-legalizing, you're going to meet upon some difficulty with the 1988 convention. So we're saying the state don't have to make it criminal. But under the 61 convention, it would have to seek to stop and prevent, so it would be a civil infraction. And that's where I think the government of Jamaica is going. Now, in the commentary of the 88 convention, I don't want the commentary, I want the convention itself, so give me a moment. That's right. Thank you. principles and the basic concepts of its legal system, each party shall adopt such measures as may be necessary to establish as a criminal offense under its domestic law when committed intentionally the possession, purchase, or cultivation of narcotic drugs or psychotropic substances for personal consumption. Now here is the rub and the catch. Contrary to the provisions of the 1961 convention. So, of course, lawyers being the creatures we are, and I'm saying this is not without argument, it's not gospel without argument, there's argument, that the 88 convention here must be read in context of the 61 convention, and it could only be speaking about possession for distribution. You with me? It's important. Because of the words at the end. Now, I'm not saying this is not without argument. There are other arguments. The possession, purchase, or cultivation of narcotic drugs or psychotropic substances for personal consumption, contrary to the provisions of the 1961 convention. So personal consumption is there, expressly said. But then it says that are contrary to the 61 convention, talking about making the thing criminal. So the conclusion here is that it could only be speaking about, that's one argument. The other argument says it's clear. It does say that. Suffice it to say that there is this argument internationally on this point. So what should Jamaica do? What should Jamaica do? Let's look at what the international body is saying, the one that's responsible, the INCB, the International Narcotics Control Board. I want us to just bear in mind that prior to the 1900s, marijuana was legal on the earth. So I don't want us to think that marijuana was always this illegal thing. And that many Jamaicans used and traded in marijuana long before. And not only Jamaicans, Indians and Americans as well. It was a push by North America, by the Americans, at the beginning of the 20th century. The Americans push, you're going to give me 5 minutes more. The American push, you're going to indulge me. The push by the Americans at the turn of the 20th century was what pushed us over into this whole criminalization thing. So if you see what one, you need to go with the wind. Where are the Americans pushing? In the other direction now. And don't say to me, but no, that's just how life is. They're pushing in the other direction. The guys in Colorado, what did the guys do? I think they have put it beyond dispute. The state government says it's illegal, you know, federally, for recreational purposes. But America have a federal system. So the guys, you see there's no standoff. Why the president kind of let them just ease in, because it's a little problematic. So the guys in Colorado have said this in Article 18 of their constitution, that's a miscellaneous section, the kind of wrap up everything section. Medical use of marijuana for persons suffering from debilitating medical conditions, as used in this section, these terms are defined as follows. And they go on and make it legal expressly in their constitution. Section 16 of their constitution, on personal use and regulation of marijuana. In the interest of the efficient use of law enforcement resources, enhancing revenue for public purposes and individual freedom, the people of the state of Colorado find and declare that the use of marijuana should be legal for persons 21 years of age or older and taxed in a manner similar to alcohol. So that's Colorado. I will close by just giving you a prips for what I'm dealing with. Well, that's it, sorry. Let me give you the other one. That's right. You must be 21 and older to have or use retail marijuana and they go on. Only licensed retailers. What is the Jamaican state to do? I think we don't have any leverage to join and beside that it'll be big time in the whole of the public space internationally on the side that says let's interpret these, you know, these conventions, because it's a fanciful thing that, because what happens when more states in America come on board? Two now have recreational, within a couple of years' time, 5, 6, 7, 10. What will the federal government do? Because it has these international conventions. Wherever America is blowing, we should be blowing. So what we need to do is just in terms of the geopolitics position ourselves, because them can't stop the brand from yassoing. This 6 months, 9 months, God, I'm a virgin, talk about the sativa. Them could have grown only if they want to grow. People will come here in large droves. I'm a little worried about going the halfway house. I understand what the government wants to do. I live in Jamaica. Once you start talking about licensing, there are issues with that. Will the small men who held it together be pushed aside? I want to grow my own ganja if I want ganja to use. So the government says I can have ganja, I want a law that says I can grow six, more than six trees, because I live a big thing that American people think that. I want a law that allows me, because guess what? Marijuana has psychoactive properties. There's a receptor in the brain, CB1. Scientists only find this out in the 1980s. So, in a long time, something, and CB2 outside of the brain. Those receptors are critical. They're cannabinoid receptors. Ganja lock into them. So it's a serious plant in that respect. I need to understand that. So I want the ability to grow my trees, and I know how I deal with my trees and how I grow my trees. I don't want to have to go and buy from someone. So I hope the government, this is not no simple thing for Jamaica, because they have the Rastafari too, and sacrament. I think for that we have to have some constitutional change, because it's only religious, it's only medicinal and scientific, and people squeezing recreational. And Rastafari, I'm going to tell you, a recreational thing involved, you know, when you're using ganja, steam up in ganja, straight sacrament. Thank you very much.
Moving along quickly to the next presenter, but before I go on, August 6, 2014, Independence Day, Jamaica became 54 years old on that day. On that day as well, a young man died in the Palma Regional Hospital. Obscure young man, 31 years old. He died as a result of beating received in the Barney Street lockup when he was locked up for possession of ganja. A split. And that led to an outcry in Jamaica about decriminalizing ganja. Now, the government has already taken a step, October 8, 2014, just a few weeks ago, to pass laws to expunge the records of people who have been, who have criminal records because of ganja. Another criminal record as well. Now, we have Dr. Mark Gillis, who will speak on the need to reconsider criminal sanctions as a tool for coping with social fallout from ganja. I want to know if the expungement goes far enough. Dr. Gillis.
I'm an American, so I can talk to some extent about... I'm an American, I can talk to a certain extent about the situation in America. I'm not really that familiar with the circumstances in Jamaica, probably. But in any case, my comments are more on a general philosophical level concerning criminality. But essentially, I want to consider whether it makes sense, talking about criminal theory, to really outlaw vices, if you want to put it that way. But my title was Vices, Not Ganja. But it's focused on ganja. Okay, I'll start by quoting my favorite poet. He's a German romantic poet, but he apart from that, I guess he had some good political sense. Here's a quote from him, a 19th century poet, Friedrich Hölderlin. And his quote was, his saying was, "What has always made the state a hell on earth has been that man has tried to make it his heaven." Actually, this is something of a theme of my talk. The desire to stamp out vice can really go overboard and cause more problems than it solves. There may be no consensus regarding what is or isn't a vice and what should be stamped out. Okay? So I'll look at this primarily from a classic libertarian perspective. That's John Stuart Mill, before the harm principle. Okay? And he's essentially saying there's no justification for forbidding action by interest of liberty. There's no justification for criminalizing action by anyone unless it causes harm to others. That's the basic principle. Now, his position is not universally accepted, of course, by any means. And one of the big problems with it is to try to define what harm means. You have to really refine the concept of harm in this respect. Now, of course, on one end of the spectrum, you might have been talking about violence and other physical injury, theft of property, and so on. But if you go toward the other end of the spectrum, you can start talking about things such as outrage or offense or moral outrage. Just in the sense that someone is engaging in conduct that you don't like or find reprehensible or something along those lines. Now, this is probably, this is where I would put the criminalization of ganja and things of this sort. You can go further extreme. There are some who might argue, unless our view of morality is accepted, of course the heavens will fall and so on, but that's really not what we're talking about. There seem to be a lot of people with that attitude in the U.S. Hopefully they won't gain any sort of control in the future. Okay, with regard to law and morality, in a sense talking about that, what constitutes harm? If you want to talk about a moral thing as harm that can be forbidden or prescribed, I would have to say it's important to have a common morality in a particular state. Otherwise you're running into problems. What we see with regard to criminalization of drugs. Defining the common morality can be quite difficult. I mean, obviously we are not able to ensure that everyone agrees. You can't have a society where you insist that everyone has to agree before you can somehow forbid things. That's just never going to work. There is justification for demanding some people, despite their differences or perspectives, to conform their behavior to the norms of society. An example we speak of always with regard to this is pedophilia. Whether or not you believe these people that it's really part of their personality or so on, that's a question we don't want to deal with. Essentially, it's pretty clear it's still justified for society to suppress that activity because of the harm it obviously does on young persons. Now, so in a sense, you don't have to require unanimity of any sort, but I would raise the point that the search for a common morality, it really can't be based on a slight or bare majority, okay? Criminal law, this is probably one of the first things I learned in law school when I was studying. Criminal law, for its efficacy, relies upon pretty much overall and almost universal acceptance of compliance. If you don't have that, then it's going to be, to a certain degree or to one extent or another, a failure. Okay, so bare majority isn't going to work. You can just see that as a larger group imposing its views or its morality upon a smaller group, and the dissenters being forced to take the brunt of their disagreement. Okay, the problem there is it brings the law into disrepute from the fact that dissenters, because they're perhaps not going to comply, or at least a certain number of them, it shows in society, it's shown that there are lots of people that flout the law, and that's not desirable for general health. So for reasons you want, I mean, one approach is to say, they flout the law, punish them, right? But another approach may be to say, well, if everyone's flouting the law, perhaps that's the problem with the law, especially criminal law, right? Okay. Another thing is, of course, those who are being punished in the dissenters, they'll view it as a means of oppression, essentially. Okay. Now, with regard to harm, and talking drug use, I'll focus on ganja. Of course, a lot of this applies to other drug use, and even legal substances such as alcohol and prescription pills and so on. But clearly, if we want to talk about harm, there's no argument that that some sort of harm results from it. Okay, in certain cases, however you want to define it. Harm, for example, obviously certain people, especially if you talk about most of your drugs, certain people become derelict, for example, they engage in risky or dangerous behavioral violence, for example, and they can ultimately suffer health problems, which a more modern society means society is perhaps going to be footing the bill for that. But at the same time, these are problems that result from legal drugs as well, say alcohol, prescription drugs, tobacco, which cause a lot more harm. It's well documented. Cause a lot more harm or deaths than marijuana. Okay. Now you could say, well, perhaps you should outlaw those, but everybody knows. I assume everyone knows this was an experiment in the U.S. The prohibition, 1920 to 1933, unmitigated disaster. I just saw a classic Humphrey Bogart film the other night by Key Largo, and part of the plot is Bogart and Bacall are kidnapped in a small hotel in Florida by some former gangsters. It's like after World War II, but they used to run alcohol during Prohibition, and the whole time during the film they're saying, we got to bring Prohibition back, because essentially their idea was Prohibition was good for us. It's one of the things I actually wanted to ask him a question, or raise an issue. People here, I mean, obviously there's industry now, even though it's illegal. Do a lot of people here wish to keep it illegal for the very purpose of being able to keep profits? I'm assuming that this would seem to be the case. Okay, and you could say ganja, when we talk about comparison to alcohol, tobacco, also some other form of prescription drugs that are illegal. Ganja doesn't necessarily cause these harms. Okay, I won't go into details, I think everyone knows that. Okay. We just say, when we talk about criminal policy, criminalization of marijuana, in my view, perhaps other drugs, but I won't go into those, causes much more harm than good. I think that's pretty clear. The harm that it causes far more extensive than far worse. Causes a huge growth in crime. So, for example, the crime that's caused by marijuana person, it's crime because since you define use or possession as crime, people that do that are criminals. Right. Then, of course, inevitably, because they have a desire for this thing, it doesn't necessarily get stamped out by the criminal prohibition, societal disapproval, and an industry develops around it. And since that industry is illegal, of course, they're committing crime, engaging in violence, for example, in order to protect themselves, their crops, and everything else. Okay. Then the price, as a result, the price goes up, of course, and the persons who use and buy these items are perhaps pushed, in some cases, to crime in order to be able to afford the higher prices that are paid. Okay. Then we can also see, in a sense, non-crime harm, if I put it that way. This has pretty much been raised with regard to the economic questions. It diverts a great deal of money from the legitimate economy, right? There is no opportunity to regulate the substances of various things, dangerous substances, for example, or like in Colorado, I was surprised it said 21 and older, rather than 18, but actually I guess that's the drinking age as well. It makes it more possible to keep it out of the hands of children. And state loses tax revenues, of course. Right, at the same time, this is an important one, in terms of criminal policy, they're spending a massive fortune to try to eradicate, to stamp out this activity. Right? This goes into keeping a huge population in prison, spending a lot of money to